time span, like 6 months. It's not like right away. You can say, I don't like what
they
you
can ask for it right away, but it's a waste to do it. Their attorney will tell them, don't do it right away. Wait till see how you what happens after a couple months with the medication to get the medications right. You know, we all know it. The medications don't work right away, A, and the medications are wrong or they need to be changed.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what the process is. They just come out of the hospital when they get on a conservatorship, or they're just coming out of the prison, and they're still in the process of finding the right medication or the best medication cocktail for them.
I'm trying to understand. So if you do a court hearing and you rule that they're going to be conserved, they don't like the ruling, so they can say that they want to have a rehearing.
Right, up to two.
Up to two. Okay. Can one of those be a jury trial?
No, they're in front of me.
In front of you again.
And they have
see. Okay.
And they have the burden of proof.
Okay.
To show that they are no longer gravely disabled.
It's not in front of another attorney. It's got to be in front of you.
It's in front of me. Well, it's in front of whoever is sitting there.
I do have one more question.
Okay.
A lot of times we have patients that are in the hospital, and doctors are notorious for saying, "Oh, unless they've had like 10." The doctor, when they're hospitalized, the doctor says they have to have 10 hospitalizations or something like that before we'll initiate the LPS conservatorship because the judge will not approve this. I know. The law just says if they're gravely disabled and they have a serious mental illness, they can be put on the conservatorship. Now, it's a person who has no insight into their illness, they're not willing to take medication, and they're not willing to be in any treatment, would you grant an LPS conservatorship in that case?
All right, so the question is, the experience that Evangelita has had is that some doctors, when you're in the hospital, they'll say, I'm not gonna refer them for an LPS because they haven't been hospitalized enough times. They need at least 10 times or some number. That's not the law, of course. But that's what the doctor's experience is. They think that the courts are somehow count the number of hospitalizations as a minimum. The law just requires that because of their mental illness, that they can't take care of themselves. Now, of course, people will come in who are doing pretty well after they've been medicated, and they swear up and down that they're going to keep taking their medication if they're off the conservatorship. They've got a plan, and then someone tells me, or on cross-examination from the county council, they will tell me how many times they've been hospitalized and how many times they've failed. I have to take all that into account. Now, just because someone was hospitalized 5 times before doesn't mean that they might not succeed this time. But I have to take all that into account. And clearly, if someone doesn't believe they have a mental illness, I can't trust that they're going to keep taking the medication that's made them do so well. So that is itself, there's a case on this, that is enough to find that the person remains gravely disabled.
Or could be put on an LPS the first time on their first hospitalization.
Yeah, well, certainly on the first time, because most people who are contesting the case believe that they're not mentally ill.
Right.
They think they have attention deficit disorder, they have a variety of other things, it was a rash, it was a cold, not mental illness. And I understand there's a stigma, right, for mental illness, right? It's hard for all of us to talk about the people in our families that have mental illness to other people because there's a little shame. And certainly for people in the my court, I know they are very worried about being labeled as mentally ill. In the jail, whenever we have a professional go and see a person to evaluate them, we have to, the jail people will say, oh, you need to see the doctor, it's a med thing. They will never say psychiatrist or psychologist, because that person, if they're, especially if they're in a gang, is gonna be beaten up or killed. So they don't do that. So there's a tremendous amount of persecution in our society for people who are mentally ill, and I'm obviously talks preaching to the choir. You know that. And that's why when I get people in court, that is driving a lot of their resistance to the being placed on a conservatorship. I understand that. So, well, in all the cases, it is my mission, and it's my staff's mission, and it's the attorney's mission, to be as to express as much care, compassion, and friendliness to people, to try to make it seem like this is a normal situation, and to focus on them and not make them feel like, you know, they're at the mercy of the legal system. It's hard to do, obviously, it's a balancing act. All right, so when they come into court, they can agree to the LPS conservatorship, at which time I'll make an order based on the information that the public guardian has provided, and also based on what they may ask for or their attorney will express. If it's a court trial they want, then we'll have the court trial either that day if the doctor is available. If not, it'll be within a few days. Jury trial, that takes a little time to put together. But that'll be within, if it's a first appointment, I try to set that as soon as possible, like within a couple weeks or less. If it's a reappointment, I've made the decision that I'll put those a little later. The reason being is the conservatee on a reappointment has already had a right to appeal the prior judgment, has had a chance to come in twice, up to two times on a rehearing. So they've had lots of opportunities to get off of a conservatorship. If they waited a year till the reappointment, I can put them a little bit behind, so it's maybe it would be a month later that we will pick up the issue of their jury trial. Yes?
Yeah, what kind of procedure is in place if the doctor keeps no showing?
There is no good procedure. So if the doctor doesn't come, and we have had that, then the public guardian is unable to proceed and the petition gets dismissed. It's a very, very sad situation. Now, there are facilities that have what are called forensic doctors. These are doctors who are hired to just appear in court. So they don't treat patients, or they don't treat patients at the facility. They may have their own patients, but they just come into court. They know what the legal definition of being gravely disabled is. They can testify to that. They certainly can look at the talk to the person and look at the charts and records and say this person has a mental illness and explain why that mental illness will interfere with their ability to care for themselves. Now, here's what we're looking for as far as being unable to take care of themselves. We're looking at psychotic symptoms like delusions or paranoia that would prevent someone from walking in and buying food or staying in a shelter even. I don't mind if someone wants to be homeless, as long as they can go to a shelter when they need to or get services when they need to. That's their choice. I can't make decisions for everyone. I've had very happy people who live on the streets because that's what they want. They don't want to live inside of a building. But they knew how to take care of themselves. So that's important. I need to see if their mental illness will prevent them. And paranoia, as you can imagine, is one of those things that will, you know, if they think that they're going to be poisoned by the food, they're going to, we've had people, you know, lose 80 pounds, right? So they come in so frail because they won't eat anything that's given to them. They think it's all poison. If someone gets into fights easily, because they are we call it labile, they just go from 0 to 60 in 2 seconds because of their mental illness, that may also arguably be a basis for finding them disabled, gravely disabled, because they can't stay anywhere. A shelter will kick them out. They couldn't live with family, friends, without medication, they cannot survive in a shelter, and they don't want to live on the streets. So other things that we look at.
If somebody is presenting well in front of this doctor, all of a sudden they look perfect, Is there a protocol that the doctor has where he can question, besides looking at the charts, that he can question this person specifically that will bring him the answers he needs to understand if they're sick or not?
So sometimes on reappointments, often on reappointments, and even the initial appointment, the person has, the patient has had enough medication or is very savvy. We have the bipolar patients, and they work the system, they work the doctor.
Yes.
Oh boy.
And very well. They know the answer.
They're very
and
smart.
They try to work me too. And I'm sitting there doing my best to try to figure out what's going on. It's not easy. This is when having actually family members testify it helps. Oftentimes, the doctor will say, we don't feel the person is gravely disabled. And so then there'll be what's called a no recommendation, and we dismiss the petition. It is crucial. There's no science to this. And one of the key issues will be a history of hospitalizations. And we know that yes, they can game the system, but then they fail right away. And so we look at that. But I have to have that evidence, and that evidence may be difficult to get in. Oh, you had your hand up.
I think in the line of her countless systems, sometimes they have episodes.
Right.
They wouldn't take care of themselves for a while, and then something triggers them, and then they're not able to. So is there financial assistance, I guess, inside? Like, if they don't want to be in a facility, they don't want to be in invited to home, they want to be able to enter the society by themselves, and they're able to pay their bills themselves. They're in denial. They don't know that they're not able to because of mental illness. So, along with conservatorship and, you know, family helping them to pay their bills, financial assistance, do they help them to live a normal life in their home instead of being in a facility? But again, they don't trust people. They don't trust the food. They don't trust the staff. I want to be able to live on my own.
So you brought up the huge problem we have in our mental health system. There should be people that be able to visit them and say, how are you doing? And do you need this, do you need that? And there's a whole different, some countries approach mental health in a completely collaborative way. We want the patients to be the doctor, to be driving their mental health, to encourage, we have to educate them, of course, but we would like them to say, oh, this is what I need. Instead, we tell
them. They don't.
We
don't think they need.
Right. No, but that's because we tell them you need this, and they say no. And this is an ongoing problem. We know that. And you know, we live in a society which is parent-child based. You know, and so people don't want to be treated as children when they become adults, and that's the challenge.
The full-service partnership would help in that case.
So this is what I was going to say. We do have. Of course, there's disability income, SSI, but you can find a full service partnership. It's not easy to get it set up, but you call the Department of Mental Health and see if you can get the referral into where you get extra support. There's also something called assisted outpatient treatment, AOT. That is actually under the LPS Act. This is when someone has been hospitalized more than twice, I think, in the last few years, and
incarcerated and homeless,
and there are a couple of other requirements. It's a small division of the Department of Mental Health, but they will bring petitions to have those people, those patients, given the assistance of outpatient treatment, not as good as a full service partnership, but a really dedicated group of people that will come and try to solve and help that person with all sorts of problems so they can live in their home. Mm-hmm. So AOT is what that's called.
What if the patient doesn't want that type of help? If they recognize they have mental illness, and if they were to appear in court after 3 weeks of medication, they would present well, and they don't want the outside help or interference. It's more, it's